come across. And the high levels of the aldosterone due to the juxtaglomerular hyperplasia will also increase the potassium and hydrogen exchange for the sodium. And that is the reason they will also show the presence of the hypokalemia in addition, is what I like to underscore to all of you. So what is the final consequence that you basically have the patients who are having Bartter syndrome, doctor? They have salt losing, they have normo or hypotension, they have juxtaglomerular hyperplasia, they also have got hypokalemia. This is the combination that you come across. And also growth retardation because of the rise of the prostaglandin E2 is what I like to underscore. In addition, what else will happen? How is their acid-base disturbance in Bartter syndrome? They will also have metabolic alkalosis because all the aldosterone will cause retention of sodium and loss of potassium and H+ ions. And that is the reason they also have alkalosis. And they also have hypercalciuria in addition to that. Now, we are talking about two syndromes, na? One is called Bartter, we said. Other is called Gittleman. Now, what is the fundamental difference between that of the Bartter and that of the Gittleman? The only difference is everything is same. The only difference is losing calcium. Losing calcium into the urine is a feature of the Bartter, but there is no losing of calcium into the urine in the case of the Gittleman, which is the differentiating factor between the two, is what I like to underscore to all of you. So summarize, doctor, for at least 2009 entrance, very short individuals, low to normal blood pressure, volume depletion will be there, and due to the hypocalcemia, they will have tetany and muscle spasms, etc., etc. That is what you come across. Let us go to the next question. Perinatal mortality, what is the most common cause? How many answered it as anything else other than asphyxia? Is a potential answer from anybody? No, it's a standard question. Late fetal deaths and early neonatal deaths combined put together is called perinatal mortality. About 2/3 of all perinatal deaths occur in the children who are less than 2,500 grams of birth weight. And out of all the causes, it is the birth asphyxia which is the most, perinatal hypoxia is the most common cause, is what I like to underscore to all of you. Just you can take a small paper. Any specific objections you have, please make a note. At the end of the discussion, we will also have a debate on your options also. Now, a full term, the word full term is important in this question. IUGR baby who is small for gestational age will have all the features except which feature? Basically, doctor, there are two types of IUGR, intrauterine growth retardation. Those who are small for gestational age, which, who are normal for gestational age, and those who are preterm and term. So we need to classically know what are the complications in each of this group. The small for gestational age are those whose birth weight will fall below 10th percentile of that of the gestational age. And typically, those who are small for gestational age, they will have all these complications which have been mentioned, that is respiratory distress, the hypothermia, polycythemia, hypoglycemia, etc., etc. But intraventricular hemorrhage as a complication is not a problem if they are full term. Only when they are preterm, then the intracranial hemorrhage becomes a complication. So there's a reason, because the baby is full term, there is less likelihood for him to develop the intracranial hemorrhage, is what need to be remembered. Now let us talk about the gynecomasia. Gynecomasia is a feature which is seen in certain congenital syndromes like Klinefelter and Calamans, pituitary tumors, intracranial. Then similarly testicular tumors where there is an ectopic production of the HCG. And also it is found in the case of the hyperthyroidism, not hypo, is what we need to basically understand. Is hypo and hyper, both of them are given in the actual exam also? Okay. Now let us go to the next question. When there is a contact between two people with different types of culture, there is a diffusion of the culture both the ways. What is it called as? Fundamental definitions. It's called as acculturation, is what we need to basically remember, which is also called as the culture contact. Now let us go to the next question. In severe aortic stenosis, what do you come across? Take it granted, doctor, any entrance that you go, one question on valvular heart disease. Without that, there is no paper. MS, MR, PSTR, PSPR and ASAR, they are the bread and butter of any aspirant. So you must be very sure. And that decides how clinically you are sound in your undergraduate versus not sound about it. So let us talk about what happens in aortic stenosis. The carotid arterial pulse is very small if you check it. It rises very slowly, like a low-cost ATR flight. Very slowly it will rise. So which is called as a pulsus parvus et tardus is what you see in aortic stenosis. Then aortic stenosis places the load on the left ventricle. A point of time LV dysfunction occurs, and the moment it occurs, then there is a change in pulse called pulsus alternans. One beat strong, one beat slow, one beat weak, one beat strong is what you come across. And at the apex, there is a precordial A wave which is visible, and there is a systolic thrill which can be felt in the aortic area, the right intercostal space, and sometimes that can become even transmitted to the carotids. That is what you see in aortic stenosis. Then one of the options given was, do you find a heaving apex? Some of you are house surgeons, let us take that opportunity. What are the different types of apices that you know, doctor? The fundamental first year clinical medicine posting. Double impulse, you have it in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Tapping apex, what is that? In the mitral stenosis, that loud first heart sound you listen with the stethoscope. The counterpart of that in the palpation is the presence of the tapping apex in the case of the loud, in the case of the mitral stenosis. Then a hyperdynamic thrusting apex is what you see in the case of a aortic regurgitation, pregnancy, beriberi, etc., etc. Then a sustained apex beat is what you see in the case of the aortic stenosis. Then when do you see heaving apex? Heaving apex is a feature which is a sign of the left ventricular hypertrophy. Do you have that in aortic stenosis? Very much. So that's the reason heaving apex should be a feature in the case of the aortic stenosis. But the only thing is, are you sure that outwardly displaced apex was also a part of the question, or only it was heaving apex? That is also there. Now I like to ask you, in a case of aortic stenosis, you don't have dilated cardiomyopathy, you have a hypertrophic heart, left ventricle. Will that become displaced outward? Generally not. Unless there is an aortic regurgitation with the dilatation which is concomitantly there, then that is a very important coexistence situation. Then let us continue. What other things happen in the case of the aortic stenosis? How will be the S1? S1 is something to do with the mitral valve and tricuspid valve. So there is a reason S1 is usually normal, or sometimes it can be soft. Then there can be a paradoxical splitting of S2. What does it mean? Normally, aortic A2 component will be before the P2 component. But because aortic stenosis A2 becomes so delayed, it comes closer to the P2, it in fact will be heard after the P2, which is called the paradoxical splitting of S2. Then what else do you listen in the case of the aortic stenosis? There's an ejection sound, and sometimes if the valve is thickly calcified, even that may be lost totally. And the sound occurs around 40 to 60 milliseconds after the onset of the S1. And what is the difference between pulmonic stenosis, which also leads to an ejection sound, versus that of the aortic stenosis leading to the ejection sound, doctor? Typically, the pulmonic ejection sound intensity will vary with respiration, unlike the aortic ejection sound, which does not vary, is what need to be remembered. Now, what else will happen? The atria will be contracting into a very stiff, non-compliant, hypertrophied ventricle in the left. So that produces what? Atrial gallop. That is, S4 will be heard. Because why will the, when will atria will contract, doctor, in the last one-third of the ventricular filling? And during that time, how is the ventricle in the aortic stenosis? It is thick and non-compliant. And that causes the rumbling of the blood when it gushes into the ventricle under the forceful contraction of atria, and that produces what is called as the S4 is what need to be remembered. Then how will be the systolic murmur? which you listen in the case of aortic stenosis. It is a typical crescendo decrescendo murmur, and it is more prominent at the apex, and calcification is one thing that also will decide it, and sometimes it may be confused with that of another systolic murmur. What is the other systolic murmur you listen? MR also can cause a systolic murmur, but that is more of a pan-systolic murmur. So this kind of a confusion which is caused by the systolic murmur of the AS because of its radiation towards the apex and causing confusion with the MR's systolic murmur, what is it called as? It is also called as a Gallivardian phenomena, is what you need to basically remember. Now the question comes, if more severe is the AS, do you listen more intense systolic murmur of AS? Is there any relationship? There is no relationship between the intensity of the systolic murmur and the severity of AS. But what is related? The duration of listening the murmur and the point where it is heard during systole is definitely related to the severity. The more severe the AS becomes, the later in the systole, mid to late systole, it will undergo a peaking, and it become of a longer duration murmur, the more severe becomes the AS, is what need to be remembered. And the moment the left ventricle fails, the murmur becomes softer. If you are listening a murmur in a case of AS, means ventricle still functioning, it is not totally a lost left ventricle, is what need to be remembered. Now the options given was, how is the S2 in the case of aortic stenosis? Is it loud or is it soft is a very important question. A loud S2 is a feature of the aortic regurgitation, whereas the soft S2 is more often a feature of the aortic stenosis and pulmonic stenosis, is what you need to basically remember. Why in the case of the aortic regurgitation you will have a loud S2, doctor? It takes a little more time. Our regular cardiology sessions will take care of that. So, but what are the causes for a soft A2 and soft P2? Aortic stenosis and pulmonic stenosis are the common causes responsible. So, what is the odd man out in the four options in the question, doctor? Loud S2 is not a feature in the case of the aortic stenosis, is what you need to basically understand. Now, let us go to the next question. Were there any other options? What is the? Achay, it is not except about it. Okay, if it is not except, loud S2 is gone, then a heaving apex is more likely to be a possibility if there is a left ventricular hypertrophy. But the same time, the was it a systolic murmur or a click which was mentioned in the exam? Click was there. So then very much there is a systolic click. So I just leave it to the benefit of doubt. Outward, if the word is there, still outward does not qualify, because outward is not a feature unless, yes, persistent ST changes, unless there is a severe ischemia. But all cases of what you call severe AS will not have ischemia. Let me tell you, if I have a rheumatic heart disease with a valvular a rheumatic pathology, and that led to development of AS, if I am very young, my ventricle can be able to compensate for it, and the ST changes are the ones which are more likely a marker of the left ventricular strain pattern, which need not be there in all the cases.